Good afternoon, friends. I'm Steve Ben-Nun. You're watching Israeli News Live, and several things we're going to be talking about today. So I'm not going to waste any time. We'll want to get right into it. My wife's channel, Yana Ben-Nun, Rise Up Children of God, got a strike, and the channel is under suspension for 1 week. That was because she dare to challenge this gentleman that claims to be a Christian over there out of Israel, that is saying that, actually misquotes her, and she went on the defense against that and made a video about it. And of course, that video was removed, and she received a strike as well, suspended for a week. So Yana will actually be producing her videos either on DLive, which will probably kick up tomorrow, or one of our other channels there. I'll post in the links below there all of our different channels. And don't forget also, you might even be able to see that video. I have not looked yet to see if that is on the app or not. I know that Bill gets a lot of those things up there on the app, so maybe that is still on the app. It is on Patreon as well. Patreon, Israeli News Live Patreon account. It's over there, so you can see it there. And this is what we keep talking about. Look, we're doing all kinds of channels trying to find all kinds of ways to keep you guys informed, because we are being censored like never before. And then there was someone said that the Israeli government was curious about us. Well, the Israeli government knows us. We've been to the Knesset. They know who we are. It's not like some mystery to them. But I will say one thing. The attacks already started early this morning. I went on with John Moore on his program there. We do on Tuesdays. Every Tuesday at 9 a.m. Eastern time. And sure enough, while I'm on using my phone on the Skype there, they were playing in the background some, like, some kind of football game or something. Everybody's screaming and yelling, and I'm like, good night. I'm like, the hackers are hacking in on Israeli News Live no matter where we are or what we're doing. And if the hackers are not there, the hecklers are there. And if the hecklers are not there, the Pharisees are there. Anyway, so Yana's channel is down, and by the way, Yana is here a lot on Israeli News Live. That is my heart. That's the apple of my eye. As the bride of Christ is the apple of Jesus' eye, and so we consider ourselves his bride as well, so we like to be the apple of his eye. She is the other part of me, and I know there's some people out there that complain about her being on Israeli News Live. You've taken over the channel, things like that. You know, listen, I have pushed her to come more actively involved, because the amount of research she has done is so overwhelming, and the truth must be told, and I need her help. And so when you speak against her, you're speaking directly against me as well. And so please keep that in mind. We appreciate you, but keep that in mind. So at any rate there, I'm going to let that go, because that can really become a personal issue that bugs me a lot. So, also, I want to share with you Richie from Boston. I know Richie and I, we've had some things we disagree a little bit on, but for the most part, I really appreciate what Richie does, and I hear his channel got banned. And, you know, look, when we were down for a week, it had been nice if we'd have had, we had a lot of you out there letting people know we were down. We appreciate that. But I want to do for Richie what I would have loved to have seen happen for us. Now, wouldn't expect it from Richie, but he's actually banned from YouTube on his channel. And his other channel that had a decent amount of subscribers, he's on suspension on. But Richie does have another channel called The Banned One 911. And I want you to be able to have the ability to go there and subscribe, because Richie gives a lot of good information. And you know, and I appreciate what he does. He's only got 36,000 subscribers there. I'll put a link in the description below for you. I'll make sure to put it near the top so you can find it easily. So you can, those of you that are following what Richie is, the updates he puts out, you'll be able to do so. And there is an attack on anybody that is telling the truth there. True News also, I was hearing just moments ago that he was on a Facebook talking about the attack that he's under by Lori on her platform there, coming against him, and I can probably see why. He's got a new one out, new video out, Evangelicals for Hire. Israel paid U.S. Christian Zionists to push propaganda. Well, let me tell you something. I actually know a little bit more about that particular story for a fact. So I'm not going to go diving off into that. We already got some fires on the front lines on our side there. But I could tell you, Rick Wiles and the crew over there, Matthew, all you guys over there, Doc, we appreciate the work you do. But yeah, I know information about that firsthand. So yeah, I would have to say they are for hire. There is some truth to that. I haven't listened to the video yet. Gonna have to do that. But a lot of truth to that, and very sad to say. And I'm going to be talking here in just a little bit about Gilad Otsman, who is on our program today. Sadly, we had to actually close the comments on this. There's a lot of good comments now. Granted, a lot of good comments, but the trolls are loose. Those people that, you know, they're out there just trolling us anyway because they don't like something I said, you know, 6-7 years ago, whatever the case may be. And even so, you know, listen, I'm going to take this. I'm going to show you exactly the type of people that is. The type of people, not Gilad, but the type of people that attack people. I'm going to show you what type of people those people are. And I'll tell you something about Gilad. I really, listening to him, I really appreciate this man. Somebody placed one comment in the video there, and it wasn't necessarily a bad comment. I just want to know. They said, is this now a pro-Palestinian, anti-Israel channel? No, it is a pro-life channel. Maybe that's a good way to describe Israeli News Live. Pro-life. We care about human beings, period. And by the way, this thing, this huge attack against Palestinians. You know, there is a document that is claimed to be by Moses that was in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And I know some people don't like it when you say, oh, you're taking something from the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's extra biblical. Well, let me tell you something. Those people that run around saying that that's extra biblical, you're not afraid to use Bible codes. You're not afraid to use Talmud, Midrash, Mishnah. You're not afraid to go out and quote every Tom, Dick, and Harry out there that probably doesn't know anything about biblical prophecy, but will sit there and espouse those doctrines. So before you go to judging, you need to think about what you're saying. Because in the Dead Sea Scrolls, which I do not agree with all of them by no means, but I do look at the historicity of those documents there, especially when I've got documentation in the Dead Sea Scrolls that clearly identify that Jesus was the Messiah. Describe him to a T, what the Messiah would be like. What, 150, 200 years before he ever came? And we don't even know if that's when it was written, but that's what's in there. And you know, maybe that might just help our Jewish friends to recognize that Jesus is the Messiah. Maybe they can't quite take what you believe, but they might take something like that and say, wow, you know, maybe he was the Messiah. I know Gilad has a great appreciation for Jesus. The one Jew, as he spoke about on Adam's program, he was nothing but about love and peace, equality. And yes, he was. But as I was going to say here, in one of those documents there where they say Moses wrote it, and the thing is that actually everything that was written there actually happened, it was prophesying that the house of Judah would go into captivity for 7 years into Babylon, another one of the documents, and it was supposedly written by Moses, but he mentions in there, and let me read that one part to you, that he mentions in there, very interesting, because he said that he would actually leave a one, like a fragment of people behind. He says right here, and I will hide my face from them and deliver them to the hands of their enemies and abandon them to the sword. And from among them, I will make survivors remain so that they will not be exterminated by my anger. Now, did that mean remaining in the land as they were gone? Which there were just a few, normally the farmers. And you know, it's the same way it was. The reason I brought that up, because it's the same way it was in 70 AD when the Roman General Titus came down and destroyed Jerusalem, what did they do? You know, many of them were taken captive, but the farmers were allowed to stay. The Palestinian people, and of course not all of them, there are some, there are many like over in Gaza, they're Egyptian, there are many that are also, you know, maybe 50% we have are Egyptian and Jordanians that live either in the West Bank or Gaza, all right? But the other 50% are indigenous to this land, and they have been there ever since the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Their families are able to trace it back. I actually know one particular family that, although they're Muslim now, said that they were the original Jewish people there. They knew it. So, you know, when you're down on the Palestinians, maybe you're down on people that are really Jewish people, and you've been thinking, oh, they're just some kind of cancer on the earth or something. No, they're not. They're human beings. And they don't deserve to be treated the way they are. In fact, if anything, as a Jewish people, as an Israelite nation, knowing the commandment of God Almighty to us, not to oppress the stranger among us. So even if you took them as a stranger, you're not to oppress them because we were oppressed as well. Did you forget that? Have you, as Christians, have you forgot what the Word of God said? And you just think that we're supposed to go in there and drive all these people out? Is this the way the commandment of God is? Is this the way Jesus Christ commanded it? No. Even like when he went to the Samaritan woman, his own apostles shot. They didn't dare say a word to him either. The Samaritan woman says, "We have no dealing with you. You're Jews. We don't have any dealings with you." But he was about equality. And that's something that Atzmon Gilad seen in him, and I really appreciate the things that he has to say there. So anyway, jumping back over here though, I wanted real quick, look at the earthquake situation on the map here. I mean, this is like nuts, guys. This is like nuts. The ring of fire is lit up like a torch. I don't know how, can you guys see all this on the screen right here? Let me try to get this a little bit bigger for you. Right? Look at the United States, the West Coast over there. I mean, my gosh. Nevada, California, Utah, Oregon, Wyoming, everywhere, earthquakes. Now, these are not big, you know, threes and twos, high twos, things like that. But they're there, 3.5. Just another one just now happened. They're right there all around the California-Nevada border, 2.5, 3.4. Oh my gosh, just, oh, I mean, the earthquakes are going off like nuts right now. In America, Alaska, look at all the earthquakes in Alaska. I mean, this is like insane, 3.0, 3.4, 2.5, 3.0, 3.8. Jumping over into Russia there, 5.5 in Palana, Russia. Okay? And then right down here in Hawaii, just had an earthquake there a few minutes ago, 2.5. But you get down here right off the coast of Chile, and since I actually put this up on here, there's been another earthquake, it looks like over in Bolivia or Argentina 1, 6.5 right there, Chile. Right? Let me blow this in. These are all off the coast there. Look at all the earthquakes. I mean, my gosh, what in the world is going on? I mean, I have never seen that many earthquakes in one place in a 24-hour period. Look at that, 4.8. Another 4.8, 4.5, 5.4, 5.0, 6.8 magnitude of Alinar, Chile. Right off the coast there. Another 6.3, 5.5, another 6.5, 5.7, 4.6, 5.7, 5.0. And keep on going. Look at there. 3.9, 4.3, 4.3. I mean, this is insane, guys. Insane. Now, like I said, this one here just popped up to a 4.2 in Papa Argentina, Pampa. Actually, maybe I'm saying that wrong. And then you got it down here by the Antarctica, South Shetland Islands, 5.4. Okay. And just checking over here just to see what we've got. I don't know. What is that? Afghanistan, it looks like? No. Yeah, Afghanistan, sure enough. I just won in Afghanistan, 4.6. And then you have the other one here in Kazakhstan, 4.2. Not too many over in that area there. Everything seems to be centered around this ring of fire right now. And it is a ring of fire. Japan also coming in at a 4.5. Down in Indonesia, 4.8. Also down in the Fiji Islands there, 4.7. 4.9. Not to mention the huge typhoon headed up there to South Korea as we speak right now with like 145 mile an hour winds. Things are getting, they're heating up like nuts. And I know, of course, we also, by the way, speaking of those detractors and stuff, don't forget, of course, today's September 1st. How many out there are saying, well, if there's no asteroid hits the Earth on September 1st, he's a false prophet. Let's clarify one more time. As I said a few days ago, prophecy is when the Lord tells you something's going to happen and you speak it, and it's either it happens or it doesn't happen. If it doesn't happen, you're a false prophet. I didn't say anything about God saying to me anything about asteroids coming. All the information I give you about asteroids, I don't tell you there's a dream or anything like that. Nope, I haven't done that. I have talked about dreams before, rising waters and major earthquake that would happen. Never set a date on it. I don't set dates. I'm not into dates. But I did tell you that the weather would begin to change. I actually read verbatim from the intel that I had on this back in March. That, what was it? May we'd start to see the weather changes coming. June, July, it would start really getting bad. Earthquakes, things like that, September, all right, you got to keep in mind, I'm dealing with multiple sources. In September, there would be something that would take place to where there would be no question anymore that we are in serious trouble. I never said September 1st. Later, we find out there is a asteroid passing by the Earth on September 1st. I've never said it would hit. So let's get your facts right. One, that's not prophecy. All right? That's intel sharing what they know. Now, earthquakes? Hello. Do you see what we're talking about, though, on earthquakes? Louisiana's hurricane, the strongest in 150 years. That's according to what the Weather Channel said. I don't know. I could ask my son. He's smart on that kind of stuff. He'll know if it was or was not. Right? But then what do we have? The derecho storm. That was something else I told you on that back in March. Again, it wasn't nothing prophesying. It was intel. That you would see storms sweeping across the northern part with 100 plus mile an hour winds. Who would have ever thought that? Then they get this thing, they call it a derecho, some rarity thing. And originally it was estimated 110 mile an hour winds. Later they came out with another news thing, 140 mile an hour winds. Then the very man that shared that intel from the Pentagon with me said that's only the beginning of those storms. It will get worse. So we are. Now, granted, I will admit one thing. The weather phenomena seems to have come a little slower than what I thought. I expected it to come a little bit faster. But now we're seeing today, these earthquakes are going like nutcases out here. And I did anticipate that there would be more hurricanes this season. However, there are more forming already. There's another one down there on the southern side of the Gulf. I don't know if that's considered the Gulf where that's at. That's gonna hit the Mexican Peninsula there, or the Yucatan Peninsula. There are two other tropical disturbances that could form into hurricanes. So I did expect that to be a little bit bigger from what I was being told. But then I was told by other intel secondary sources from the Pentagon as well that confirmed what I was telling you guys about September. But I was told there that you would actually be able to see the Planet X system, you would actually be able to see it with the naked eye. And that if you didn't see it by sometime in September, never September 1st, sometime in September, that it would be able to be seen the following year in the spring of the year, if it wasn't visible this particular time right now. So, again, will it actually become visible? I don't know. I know I've been sent a picture that's been circulating claiming that it was Planet X, or at least something like that, or one of the moons, or something like that, from a FAA weather cam. And I know I've talked to Scott with Planet X News. He completely says it's not true. I sent to my Pentagon source there about the issue as well. He also wrote me that it was, that it was an atmospheric, or it could be. He even admitted that it could be something on the lens. But there, I'm still looking into it, though, and still bear with me, because I am getting information that there are things there on other cameras as well. But Scott tells me that many of those cameras have these condensations in there because of the extreme weather changes and things like that. So it's a good possibility that's the case. But I don't know, so I've not rushed to judgment on it. But let me share with you, though, what was told to me. And I wanted to share this with you. And it was in the same letter that we were discussing this. Rest assured, Planet X is not directly causing this. That was the phenomena that the photo that was sent to me, and I did forward that on to the Pentagon. But the cloud is part of Planet X storm, you might say. All right, now he's not talking about the clouds that were in the sky that you were seeing in the picture. He's talking about this debris field that we talk about. And I can't wait, because I know that people are going to go, especially my friends that are flat. Let me put it this way. The friends that I have that are flat earthers, they're not going to come beat me up over this stuff. All right. If anything, they just probably humor me and say, well, Steve, you know, we love him. He means well. But the trolls that are really bent in a weird way, they will want to come beat you up over it. I am going to go into this issue from my perspective in a respectful way to flat earthers, because I do have a lot of friends that are flat earthers. But I am going to go into that issue because I really need to address it, especially from the Hebraic scriptures that I feel like have really been misused in that. And I do believe in a firmament, so don't get me wrong. It's not that I don't believe in a firmament, but there's a lot of things that could be said on that. So at least humor me then, all right? Because, you know, if you end up finding the rock star hitting this Earth, if you think, like I said before, if you think it's the dome breaking apart and falling down, which really in my mind doesn't make sense, because if the God of all creation made a dome that can crack and flake and fall apart, he doesn't do a very good job, does he? So, you know, and I don't think Russia thinks it was a dome falling off either. So, listen, just bear with me, at least humor me in this, all right? Because I don't say this for sensationalism. I don't like sensationalism. I say it because I care about human beings. I care whether or not, you know, whether or not this is man-made, whether or not this is weather weapons, whether or not it's asteroids or anything else, whatever you want to call it, doesn't make any difference to me. Something is going to happen, and I know it's going to affect humanity on this Earth, and I care about humanity, and I'm hoping you will be prepared for it. All right? So anyway, so as I read on this, the debris, asteroids, etc., right, as of June 2020, events have started with the arrival of the outer bands of the cloud, of debris, asteroids, etc., which will gradually increase in frequency and ferocious. Along with this cloud comes not only debris, asteroids, etc., but electrical and magnetic disturbances that are proportional to cloud density. Now, I have not actually asked the friend of mine there in the Pentagon, this as of yet, but when he put on there electrical and magnetic disturbances, this makes me wonder if this is the reason why the company EMP Shield, which we promote that company, I'll tell you straight up, I promote it because I believe in the product, right? They were given a deadline to be able to have these installed. I can't discuss when that deadline is, but the government has a deadline when they wanted it installed. Could it be because of the electrical and magnetic disturbances? I don't know the answer, so I'm not going to assume. I will ask to see if that could be the case. All right, but let's continue on. Now, and maybe even Scott over with Planet X News would agree with the electrical and magnetic disturbances, but he is going to be looking at that from the solar minimum. All right, I appreciate that as well. Imagine that space debris, asteroids, etc., have a high content of iron and metal, each having their own polarization. When spinning, which is what asteroids do, eddy currents and static, and he gives me a link for that, and I will share that link with you, it's an informative link, are generated that interfere with heavenly bodies like the Earth and the Earth's magnetic shield, ozone, etc., and cause many visual and physical challenges. Now, that was also his answer in regards to the photo. So, was it a visual and physical challenge? I don't know the answer. But you have to understand, this scientist here that sent me the information does believe Planet X is coming. And I do know that he did write further. We were writing more into there. We are still looking about 2 years out before we see the catastrophic events of the eye of the storm, if you want to call it that. But there again, that's a different issue altogether, and that's the date that's the rough time frame he's talking about. That's not a prediction or a prophecy on my part. I only quote the information that I am given. All right, so let's continue on, jumping back over here to the things that are going on here. Also, this coming out momentarily lapseofsanity.com's website, prophecy alert, Middle East peace, UAE and Israel first flight, Kushner prays at the wall. I was talking about Paul Begley. I didn't know about that there, but anyway, I didn't catch that part about Paul being on this here, but anyway, I was just noticing the fact that Kushner was part of this thing going on. Now, I don't know if this is actually, you know, I was thinking this was part, let me show you what I'm thinking this was a part of, and maybe it was not. I was looking at El Al and the Israeli delegation there with the United Arab Emirates, and as the caption goes, when a picture speaks more than 1,000 words. That's what I was thinking that was part of the same thing. Maybe not. But it does talk about UAE and Israel's first flight. Yeah, so it is. Kushner, okay. But then it says Kushner prays at the wall. Paul Begley, I guess he's quoting Paul about Kushner praying at the wall. Don't know. I didn't listen to the video yet, but my point was Kushner being involved, and they're really starting to spotlight him more and more. So kind of have to keep an eye on that. Another thing that's very, very sad situation I'm seeing once again, and that is Israel bombing Damascus. A total of 11 people, mostly military personnel, were killed in the overnight Israeli missile strikes on the capital of Damascus and Dara province in southern Syria. That is very much southern Syria there. I can't say exactly how many miles that is, probably about 50 miles south of Damascus. And if you remember, I was also told by some intel personnel that I have, I can't say who these are or how I know them, But to keep your eye on, I was told to keep your eyes on Syria and on Rome. Do keep those things in mind. Keep your eyes on Rome. Keep your eyes on Syria. All right. And there's some things I would love to say, but I can't say. But I continue to watch Syria being bombarded by Israel. And what really bugs me when I see this is that knowing that when we see the attacks against Damascus, this is going, in my opinion, this is going against the command of the God of Israel in the first place. Laban and Jacob had a covenant not to do the other harm. And Bashar al-Assad has not attacked Israel at all. His father? Yes, he did. But the thing is the scripture clearly identifies that Israel would be the one that would bring Damascus into a ruinous heap, and God, and not just Damascus, not just Israel, but it would also be other nations, and I believe it'll include the United States, will be held guilty for that, and God was not pleased with it. If you look at the Hebraic language on that, you'll see that that's true. I've done many videos on that, so if you go back and look at it, you'll see God will not be happy about that. Another issue. It kind of bugs me, that really does. Thousands protest COVID-19 restrictions across Europe. The Europeans are waking up, Americans are not, but the Europeans are definitely waking up to this plandemic. But I do know, I was also told originally that when the people begin to push back, that's when they will enact martial law. That they, in fact, I was told they want them to push back. So I can only imagine what's coming to Europe, and of course it'll follow here in the United States as well. Listen, I want to take you to the scriptures here, especially in seeing the attack that we have been under by some people that I guess they feel like they mean well. I don't know, but it doesn't seem to matter. But I cannot help but remember the words of Jesus and the things that happened to him when he was here on the earth. So I kind of take, when we're under attack, I really kind of take this as a badge of honor. Let's look at what he says here. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto you. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore, which of them will love him the most? Well, Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said to him, thou hast rightly judged. He turned to the woman and said to Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house. Thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with her tears, and wipe them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman since the time I came in hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed me my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but to him little, for she loved much, but to him little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, who is this that forgives sins also? And he said unto the woman, thy faith hath saved thee, go in peace. You know, I bring this up for a purpose. One, Jesus went when he was invited, even if it was with somebody you wouldn't approve of. And I find that people often judge unjustly. And just like our guest, Gilad, this man has got a good heart. And because he cares about humanity, he is condemned. But I find Christians, or people claiming to be Christians, act more like Pharisees than they do Christians. They're quick to judge. They're quick to say, If they only knew what kind of guy this was, they wouldn't have anything to do with him. But look at the man's heart. And then I wonder sometimes why my own kindred have such a hard time coming to Christ. It's because of the judgmental nature that are in Christians. I reminded the scripture here in Matthew chapter 9. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, "Why eateth your master with publicans and sinners?" Another situation similar to that of Simon. Maybe it was the same case, just a different book. But there are several others that I marked here I wanted to share with you. This one here in Matthew chapter 22, verse 15. "Then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent out unto him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know that thou art a true and teachest the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of men." Now, I'll tell you something. This, I deal with this on a daily basis, practically, where somebody is sent to try to catch me in my words, entangle me in my speech, as they did Jesus. And Jesus said, him being the master of the house and suffered these things, how much more ye the same? So maybe I shouldn't look down on the persecution. Maybe we should just receive it gladly. But if that be the case, maybe then those that are doing the persecuting, maybe you should take note what side you're putting yourself on. Because my desire is that you would repent and get away from that. "Tell us therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not?" But Jesus perceived their wickedness and said, "Why tempt you me, ye hypocrites?" Let's look also here, Matthew 27, verse 62 and 63. "Now the next day they followed the day of preparation. The chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that that deceiver said while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again." You see, they hang around finding fault so that later they can accuse you to the Sanhedrin. You know, that's what's interesting to me, because we do have the Sanhedrin coming back in power in the world today. A beast kingdom is rising on the scene. And these very same types of people will gladly work for the Sanhedrin. They will gladly take and find all that they possibly can and report to the Sanhedrin. As Jesus said, they will deliver you up to the synagogues. Oh, yeah. What boat do you want to be in? What side do you want to be on? You know, I would much rather stand with Jesus on that day. And think about this as well. If Jesus was here, would Jesus be there killing the Palestinians? Would Jesus be there choking them out? Would Jesus be there as a Zionist preacher standing for the oppression against the Palestinians in Israel? Would Jesus be there in this day and age that we're living in right now and telling you to follow the Talmudic rabbis and to go underneath them? Because the law is going to go out of Jerusalem. Would Jesus be there promoting wars against all the other nations in the world? Think about it. Jesus came to Israel 2,000 years ago. He came to his own, and his own received him not. But his arm is still outstretched. But it's not going to be that Jesus is going to come back and submit himself like the Pope of Rome did to the Noahide law system. He will not do it. If that's what you want, go ahead. Jesus was for humanity. He was kind and loving. He did, though, drive out the money changers from the temple. So I am sure that the money changers of today would be driven out with whips. So what side would you be on? And when they came out with the Pharisaic law, actually, no one even Pharisee, they came out with one of the commandments of Moses. This woman was caught in the act of adultery. Now that wasn't the Ten Commandments, that was Levitical law. We caught her in the very act. Again, another one of those ones trying to catch him in what he would say. Moses commanded that she should be stoned. Well, Moses commanded that you're to bring both of them, not just the girl. And stone them both, not just the girl. But anyway, Jesus said, okay, whichever one of you is without sin, let him cast the first stone. I guarantee you one thing, boy. Even the Pharisees had a little bit more sense than some of the people that attack us. They all dropped their stones, each one feeling condemned within their own hearts, and they walked away. That was one day they had a little bit more brains. But today, no. Jesus called out sin. Jesus clearly identified when he dealt with the Pharisees, you hypocrites, you serpents, you vipers. He identified that beast system. But even as he went to Simon's house, who was a Pharisee, he was always with an outstretched arm for any that might repent. What side will you be on? What side will you be on? Put yourself, look at Israel today. 2,000 years ago, there were believers of Jesus that lived in Israel 2,000 years ago. There was a Sanhedrin. There were Pharisees. There were Sadducees. There were even Karaite Jews 2,000 years ago. Put yourself right now and your actions, and what side would you be on? Because I don't see very many of you standing for the believers in Israel. I see many of you, though, and I say you, that's not just the people who listen to the video. Many of you guys believe and you appreciate the work we're doing. I appreciate that as well. But I see many that will hear this video that you do just the opposite. You support the Pharisaic clan. You stand wholeheartedly with it, ready to build a third temple. Ready to kill the goats once again. Where are you that really stand with the oppressed, the poor? So when you look at somebody like Gilad Osman and he defends the Palestinian people, and many of them are Christians, maybe not your denomination, they stand for Jesus. Why don't Christians stand for them? That's fascinating, isn't it? What side do you stand for? I'm going to go deeper into these things. We appreciate, though, those of you that do support the work we do, we appreciate you. We thank you for standing with us. Our website, IsraeliNewsLive.org. Don't forget as well, Yana will be broadcasting either here or on DLive. We also have, I'll put the links below for you. So, because their channel's down, and also don't forget Richie from Boston. His channel is banned completely. His secondary channel also on a strike week suspension. But he does have this channel here called the Band 1911. I'll place that in the comment section, in the description below for you to be able to see that. I'm Stephen Ben-Nun with Israeli News Live. Good afternoon.